I was asked to speak on the myth of the science and religion wars. And this is a topic near and dear to my heart because I have discovered the extent to which young people especially, in an increasingly large demographic of the Christian world and even outside of Christianity, are becoming convinced that they can't both hold on to their religious faith and also accept scientific teachings in college or university, particularly evolutionary biology. And so a biologist friend of mine said that he feared that about, he was teaching 1,000 freshmen a year, and he feared that about 90% of them who came into his class believed that they couldn't both accept what he was teaching them and hold on to their Christian faith. But they were mostly pre-med majors or science majors. And so by the end of a four-year university education, of course they were convinced of the science. And he was afraid that in really large numbers, they were just drifting away from their religious commitments. And so I decided that I have a sort of a mission or calling to try to dispel some of these misconceptions about the ongoing negative interactions between Christianity and science. So, in this lecture, I'm going to be attacking what many of us have come to call the myth of the warfare between science and religion. I'll start with an anecdote. In 1997, I was invited to speak at a huge conference at the Museum of Natural History in Chicago. There were evolutionary biologists, theologians, ethicists, historians, and even me, a humble philosopher of science. The origin of the event was interesting in itself. The American Association for the Advancement of Science had paid for it all, while the details were worked out by a permanent committee in its main office called the Committee on Dialogue on Science, Ethics, and Religion. Some of us were interviewed by the media while we were there. The first question I was asked was, why are science and religion always at war? I answered, they're not, but you media people make it appear that they are, because you only report on conflicts, not on events like this, where we all share pretty much the same view of the intellectual world. Well, guess what? The headline on his article in the Chicago Tribune read, "Roll over, Darwin, those theologians are at it again." But I might have made some impression on him because the subtitle was a little bit toned down. It read, "It's science versus religion, but today's battle of theories is far less heated." The far less heated is to be contrasted with statements such as that of John Draper in his 1874 book titled The History of the Conflict Between Religion and Science, in which he described the hands of the church as being steeped in blood. So in the first section of this lecture, I'll present some of the history leading up to the widespread idea of warfare or interminable conflict between science and religion. Then I'll address the so-called Galileo affair, so often cited as evidence for the warfare of the church against science. Next, I'll say just a little bit about the continuing resistance by some Christians to evolution. Finally, I'll address a few of the many interesting scholarly projects that involve putting Christian theology into dialogue with current developments in science, particularly in scientific cosmology. So, section one, history of the warfare myth. The title of this section is, I confess, misleading. When I say the warfare myth, it suggests that there is a single conflict thesis. Historian of science and religion, Jeffrey Cantor, writes that there is no consensus over the precise nature of what the conflict actually amounts to. He distinguishes between a strong thesis to the effect that science in general and religion in general are necessarily in conflict because of some essential difference between the two. This he contrasts with lists of contingent conflicts. One of these will be particularly important for our purposes here, conflicts between different social groups. His example is conflict in Victorian Britain, when a group of scientific naturalists sought to wrest power from the established church. My title also suggests that historians in general reject the warfare thesis, but there certainly have been conflicts regarding Galileo's work coming to a head with his condemnation in 1633, and after the publication of Darwin's two most influential books, On the Origin of Species in 1859, and especially after publication in 1871 of The Descent of Man. I'll come back to these incidents a bit later. In what I have to say here, I'm relying heavily on a book edited by David Lindbergh and Ronald Numbers, titled Good Nature, God in Nature, published in 1986. I believe that this was a decisive turning point in histories of science and religion and puts to rest the strong conflict thesis. One of the reasons that the conflict thesis can be seen to be erroneous is that it can be rather precisely dated historically. It began with a book I already mentioned, Draper's 1873 History of the Conflict Between Religion and Science. This book was widely read. It went through 50 printings and was translated into 10 languages. I should be so lucky as to have one. It was easy to refute, however, since he blamed only the Catholics and stated that there had been continuous persecution of scientists beginning in the 4th century. I would add a philosopher's note to the historian's work. In the 4th century, and at least 7 centuries before that, conceptions of knowledge were quite different from those of today. While the Latin word scientia and its Greek forerunner episteme were in use up through the Middle Ages, scientia was combined with the Latin opinio to provide the basic concepts of knowledge. Scientia was used to refer to what we today would call deductive reasoning, and we now pretty much limit it to formal systems in logic and mathematics. Opinio did not correspond either to what we now mean by a mere opinion. It referred to a category of beliefs that were taken as genuine knowledge because they were approved by the authorities. This was probable knowledge in the sense of approvable, rather than in our current sense of being likely to be true on the basis of the weight of evidence. Even philosophy meant something different in earlier centuries. It referred simply to an organized body of knowledge, often including knowledge of the natural world, as well as ethics, politics, some version of what we would call theology, and so forth. So Draper's claim that the church had been persecuting scientists since the 4th century had to be false. There simply were no scientists, as we now think of them, until the modern period. In addition, early modern scientists themselves were nearly all Christians. Andrew Dixon White's 1896 book, A History of the War of Science with Theology in Christendom, however, turned out to be more influential than Draper's. White was the first president of Cornell University. He began writing on science and religion as part of an effort to discredit religious critics who were envious of the funds given to his new university and who were distressed by its thoroughgoing secularism, as typified by White's stated desire to create, quote, an asylum for science where truth shall be taught for truth's sake, not stretched or cut exactly to fit revealed religion, end quote. The book was initially accepted by many because it appeared to have been well researched. However, throughout the 20th century, increasingly sophisticated histories have been written, such as Robert Merton's Science, Technology, and Society in 17th Century England in 1938, and followed by an ever larger body of historical writings by many others. So a second factor in the rejection of the strong conflict thesis was simply the increasing amount and sophistication of historical studies. Lindbergh and Numbers write that the continued acceptance of White's work in light of these later histories, quote, overlooked mounting evidence that White read the past through battle-scarred glasses, end quote. What is it that left White battle-scarred? In great measure, it was one of the types of real controversy, that between conflicting social groups. Frank Turner points to a shift in prestige and power in colleges and universities from the long-held authority of religious bodies to practitioners of science. Most colleges were founded by Christian denominations, and their presidents were usually clergymen who often taught capstone courses to put the whole of the curriculum into proper denominational context. So White faced a real battle at the time in heading up a university controlled by a science-minded president against the traditional denominational control of institutions of higher education. Now, section two, the Galileo Affair. In the 16th century, as many of you probably know, Christians were killing other Christians in great numbers. Copernicus invented his theory of the organization of the universe during that time, but it wasn't even discussed at the momentous Catholic Council of Trent, which lasted from 1545 to 1563. Yet, the council's emphasis on moral reform and clearly defined doctrines meant that Galileo was born into a much more rigid church 100 years later. In light of Protestant emphases on the ability of individuals themselves to interpret the Bible, Catholic controversies continued to focus sharply on who did have the authority to determine biblical teaching. Animosities toward Galileo came to a head on just this matter. This apparently resulted from a spat between him and his old friend Maffeo Barberini, who later became Pope Urban VIII. Barberini actually enjoyed scientific arguments and was generally pleased with Galileo's work, so long as he stayed away from pronouncements on how to interpret scripture. The problem arose when, as Pope, he requested Galileo to add to his dialogue concerning the two chief world systems, published in 1632, the Pope's own argument that definitive conclusions could not be reached in the natural sciences. Galileo did include the argument, but he put it in the mouth of Simplicio, often cast as the dullard character in the dialogue. The Pope was not amused. Now, if this were all that was involved, it would sound like a tempest in a teapot. But it's important to keep in mind that acceptance of the Copernican system would in fact tear down the entire medieval synthesis, which intrinsically tied theology to the sciences, ethics, political orders, and religious orders, and practically anything else you could think of. The first problem was to completely revise Aristotelian physics with its significant ties to the rest of the system. According to Aristotle and the medieval synthesizer Thomas Aquinas, all things were composed of the four elements: earth, air, fire, and water. The elements had natural motions: earth downward toward the surface of the earth, fire upwards toward the heavens, and so forth. But this does not make sense if the earth is not in the center of the universe. 17th century scientists had already begun the wholesale rejection of the Aristotelian system, replacing his physics with another ancient philosophy, namely atomism. There was some animosity against Galileo because of the recognition of this challenge, but this was more a controversy between the old science and the new science, rather than between science and Christianity. And, as noted earlier, it was not the motivation for his house arrest. The atomism that led to such success in physics was extrapolated to all sorts of other areas, in each case replacing the earlier medieval views. For example, philosopher Thomas Hobbes, in his 1651 book, Leviathan, described the Commonwealth as a collection of atomic individuals governed by attractive and repulsive forces. Emotions were attributed to particles in motion around the heart. Thinking was particle motion in the brain. So while it is the Copernican revolution that receives most attention, the revolution from Aristotelian physics and metaphysics to atomism, I believe, has not been adequately appreciated. Section 3, Darwin's unwelcome contribution. I was invited to a meeting at the Vatican Observatory to carry out the wishes of Pope John Paul II to plan a series of conferences on theology and science. At that meeting, we concluded that nearly all contemporary problems in theology come from lack of an adequate theory of how God acts in the natural, law-governed systems of the world. Insert an aside. This was really hard luck duty. We met in the Pope's summer palace out in the village of Castel Gandolfo. And on the occasions when he happened to be in residence, I'm pretty sure that our midday meal was cooked by his chefs. And we sat out on a huge balcony looking over this gorgeous crater lake. Ah, it was really tough work. Fellow thinkers such as Galileo, Newton, Kepler, Boyle, and others, early modern scientists, is anachronistic. There were no sharp distinctions among theology, philosophy, and science until the late 18th century. Boyle and company called themselves natural philosophers, but a better term used today is physico-theologians, making it clear that they were dealing both with the nature and construction of the physical cosmos, but they were tying it intrinsically to an understanding of God's role in the universe. These contributed to the legal mechanical tradition and helped to give it precise formulation. This was a concept of natural order that featured law, design, and mechanical arrangements. The concept of a law of nature was actually developed by analogy to God's laws in the Old Testament. Just as God's law was given providentially to the Hebrews, the laws of nature were seen as God's ongoing providence. The concept of the laws of nature served as an intermediary between a thoroughly transcendent God and his creation. So the physico-theology was typical in its day of the legal-mechanical tradition that has come to define science for us today. This concept of nature was seen by some as a threat to Christianity. However, it was easily turned into an apologetic. Philosopher Wallace Matson writes that, quote, "The defense dwelt on the sublime conception of God to be derived from the majestic, inexorable, harmonious system of nature, God's creation, revealed by science." And he capitalizes the word science. In previous ages, the occurrence of miracles had provided proof of the existence, power, intelligence, and goodness of God. Now, the non-existence of exceptions to the order of nature proved the existence, power, intelligence, and goodness of God. End quote. This puts into stark relief the question of why Darwin's achievement was not welcomed by all as a magnificent contribution to the new worldview based on natural laws. Part of the reason is that Christians themselves have long been divided over what to make of the idea of an entirely law-governed universe. While conservative theologians argued that if God had created the laws of nature, he could surely interrupt them at times to suit his purposes, liberal theologians gave up on miracles and special providence, arguing that the grander vision of God was one who could provide for all his intentions by means of ingenious laws crafted at the beginning rather than by tinkering in the world at a later point. I've told my students at Fuller that a very technical way of describing the difference between liberal and conservative Protestants in the United States is that in conservative churches, people believe that God really does stuff, and in liberal churches, they don't. They love the sophistication of my theology. Another part of the answer is that Darwin had drawn the language of his theory from his cultural context. Darwin's readers were primed to find in his writings a one-sided picture, to read his often ambiguous language in a particular manner, and theologians had made major contributions. Thomas Malthus, an Anglican clergyman working in the tradition of Adam Smith's laissez-faire economics, published his book, Essay on the Principle of Population, in 1798. He argued that population, if unchecked, will increase geometrically, and now I've got to turn the graph around for you guys, this way, whereas food supply at best could increase arithmetically. Here, human commerce was understood specifically in terms of providential deism. Malthus's work was a statement on the divinely appointed role of struggle, strife, and inequality. It was a justification of suffering and death as the natural outcome of the tendency toward overpopulation, but also as the result of divine providence in that, quote, evil produces exertion, exertion produces mind, and mind produces progress, end quote. He argued that humans were by nature sinful, sluggish, and averse to work. If population and food supply could increase at the same rate, it is probable that man might never have emerged from the savage state. Malthus, Thomas Chalmers, and other theologians of his day later became Darwin's inspiration in discovering the mechanism of evolutionary change in natural selection. So divine design was not needed to account for the adaptation of organisms to their environments. Only two principles were needed: variation and natural selection. Selection would be the natural outcome of Malthusian population pressure. This theological backdrop influenced interpretations of Darwin's often ambiguous language. As a matter of fact, Darwin's theory was used to support nearly every political ideology, but it is the eponymous social Darwinism that continues to be associated today with his biology. Darwin's newfound ability to account for biological facts in terms of laws of nature would have been no challenge in itself to Christian theology were it not for the negative images of nature drawn from his theories against the background of Malthusian negative images of humankind. Darwin's popularizer, Thomas Huxley, wrote that from the moral point of view, the animal world is on about the same level as a gladiator's show. He condemned Christians for worshiping what was plainly unworthy, a God who had created a process in which evil humankind came into existence by virtue of its success over the other animals by cunning, ruthlessness, and ferocity. I believe that in contrast to those today who deny the evidence for evolutionary theory, the main motive behind attacks today still have more to do with the fear that evolutionary theology, associating us with the beasts, is destroying the moral fiber of society. But what this worry fails to take into account is the extent to which evolution of humans is now, to a great extent, cultural evolution rather than biological. Section 4, positive relations between science and theology. I hope that my brief narratives about Galileo's and Darwin's contexts has done a bit to lessen the image of science-religion warfare. I turn now to a few of the positive relations between science and Christianity. I'll mention one topic that I address most often in lectures on science and religion, but only briefly, since I believe Warren Brown will be speaking on that topic next time. This is the positive relation between developments in biology and especially neuroscience, showing that we have no need for an additional metaphysical entity, such as a vital force, to get living from non-living matter, no mind or soul to account for our higher human cognitive capacities. I argue that Christianity and Judaism have never needed any such concepts. The original view of the Bible was monist, even while highlighting the various capacities or aspects of human life. When I lecture on this topic, many people think that I'm just another theologian bowing to science, but although I did get involved in the topic via neuroscience, the reason I stick with my position is that I did a lot of research on the biblical and theological history, and the turn away from dualism had actually already begun over 100 years ago. I've just gotten home from a conference at Notre Dame in honor of Ernan McMullen, who was a historian and philosopher of science. I've always appreciated his view that science never proves a position in theology, but rather that a positive relationship between theology and science is desirable, and the word he uses for that is consonance. So neuroscience and contemporary Christian anthropology can, happily, be said to be consonant. Section 4.1, evolution and theology. Again, only the positive side. Some of you may know that for at least 1,000 years, Christian understanding of human sinfulness came from the 5th century theologian Augustine. It was based on an exegesis of the second creation story in Genesis, attributing the perversion of human nature to Adam's sin. This account has been rejected by countless scholars on the basis of textual exegesis. The corruption of the once perfect natural world and all of the suffering it causes was attributed largely to fallen angels, even more discredited on scriptural grounds, but I'll come back to that later. So if Adam's seed did not sow evil into the hearts of humans, why do we have such remarkable tendencies to go against the teachings of the Bible? Evolutionary theory provides a lot of help here. For Homo sapiens to have evolved, our ancestors had to have tendencies to retaliate against aggressors, to fight off threats to their children, to hoard food, to defend territory, and so forth. We are still predisposed to these tendencies by our genetic heritage. Recognizing this, we can see why Jesus taught us not to return evil for evil, to share with the needy, to invite strangers into our homes, and so forth. And as I said a moment ago, our evolution is now largely cultural, and the church is God's gift to culture to recondition us in these ways. Section 4.2, Creation and Cosmology. The purpose of this section is to show the relevance of a few recent developments in astronomy and scientific cosmology to theology, in particular to the doctrine of creation. Here's my thesis. In the Middle Ages, there was a consensus among theologians that the doctrine of God's creation of the universe was relevant to all sorts of cosmological issues, such as the nature of time and the question of whether the universe had a beginning. However, due to a variety of factors in the modern period, most theologians concluded that theology in general and the doctrine of creation in particular are irrelevant to the big cosmological questions. Theology is basically about humankind's relation to God. The ironic development in our own day is that science is now putting all of those big cosmological questions back on the table, and it is an important challenge to current theologians to deal with them. The issues in current cosmology that I will deal with include the following. First, assorted attempts to provide a scientific explanation of the cause of the Big Bang, and second, the so-called anthropic implications of the apparent fine-tuning of the cosmological constants. The most obvious of the theological issues that has been reopened by developments in cosmology is the question of whether God created the universe in time or from eternity. That is, did the universe have a temporal beginning, or has it always existed with its existence dependent upon God? Recall that many modern theologians argued that whether or not the universe had a beginning in time was irrelevant to the doctrine. It had been quite otherwise in earlier Christian thought. For example, in confronting Aristotle's argument for the eternity of the universe, medieval theologian Thomas Aquinas claimed that scripture does teach that the universe was created in time, but he argued that the notion of an eternal universe is not incompatible with the doctrine of creation. This is because the doctrine is essentially about the contingency of the universe, that is, its dependence for its existence on the will of God. In contrast, Thomas's contemporary Bonaventure argued that the eternity of the universe was inconceivable, in that it is impossible to add to an infinite number or to pass through an infinite series. Thus, if time were eternal, the world would never have arrived at the present day. Yet, it is clear that it has. Copernicus overturned the Ptolemaic conceptions of the organization and of the motion of the universe, but not the conception of the universe as eternal and static. However, the development of the science of thermodynamics in the mid-19th century presented problems for the assumption of an eternal universe, problems that Bonaventure would have appreciated. If physical systems can undergo irreversible changes at a finite rate, then they will have completed these changes an infinite time ago, and we could not be observing any such changes today. As is well known, in the 1920s, astronomers had to give up the idea that the universe is static. Its observable expansion forms the basis for the Big Bang theory of the origin of the universe. This sudden origin was immediately interpreted by some, believers and atheists alike, as confirmation of the traditional account of creation as temporal origination. Cooler heads refused to be tempted to claim that science had shown the truth of the doctrine. McMullen's account of the science and theology as consonant has been judged by many to be the most reasonable. He says, if the universe began in time through the act of a creator, from our vantage point, it would look something like the Big Bang that cosmologists are now talking about. More recent and highly speculative developments in theories of origins threaten this tidy consonance. A variety of cosmologists have attempted to go beyond what was once thought to be the absolute explanatory limit of science and explain the origin of the Big Bang itself. One of these is André Lindy, who speculates that our universe started out as a very small bubble in spacetime. The bubble's swift inflation produced the Big Bang. While the notion that the universe must have expanded at a fantastic rate at the beginning is widely accepted, Lindy's assumption that our universe is but one small bubble in an infinite assemblage of universes, I take to be highly controversial. For our purposes, though, it's interesting to see how the very possibility raises again the centuries-old questions of whether the universe is eternal and whether an infinite series of universes is even conceivable. In this case, So it is clear that if Lindy's cosmology were to become widely accepted, it would occasion major rethinking of Christian assumptions. One value I see in his account is as follows. The monotheistic faiths are contrasted with Eastern religions in that the latter assume cyclical recreations of the universe. It has long been argued that the linear view of history associated with the monotheistic religions is required to ensure the meaningfulness of history and of human endeavor. Yet it seems plausible to ask why an eternal God would create only one comparatively short-lived universe. The so-called principle of plenitude used by Augustine and others to account for the variety of forms of being in the universe could easily be extended, it seems to me, to allow for the expectation that a God who creates as many forms of being as possible would also create as many universes as possible. Yet, such a plenitude of universes would not count against the meaningfulness of history, since each universe would be self-contained and unique. Section 4.3, fine-tuning and the problem of evil. I'll focus here on one issue, the goodness of creation. I've just finished writing a chapter on the problem of evil, and this includes especially what Augustine called natural evil. That is, the disorder of the cosmos and the suffering caused to humans and other sentient animals by famines, floods, earthquakes, diseases, and so on. I mentioned earlier that Augustine's and his followers' attribution of this, of much of this, to fallen angels is no longer accepted. However, most approaches to the problem of evil in modern and contemporary thought have focused on human evil to the neglect of other sentient beings. So I focus here on natural evil as it affects humans and animals. A first step in providing a credible treatment of natural evil is to recognize that purely natural evil is the simple consequence of the regular working of the laws of nature. Children fall and injure themselves because of the law of gravity. Mountain climbers freeze and people starve to death because of the laws of thermodynamics. Deadly bacteria and viruses evolve by means of the same biological laws that have produced ourselves. Of course, much suffering, especially human suffering, is a result of both natural and moral evil. For example, famines are often produced by a combination of factors such as drought and war. The early modern philosopher G.W. Leibniz was much maligned for his claim that this is the best of all possible worlds. He argued that the more we understand the interconnectedness among things and events, the less we can imagine a world that preserves all of the goods of this one and eliminates all of the evils. This observation can be all the better supported in light of current science, especially by noting the connections that can be drawn among the laws of the various sciences, from physics to sociology. One important contributor to the goodness of a world, in Leibniz's view, is the feature whereby the most varied results are produced by the simplest set of laws. On this account, Leibniz would have considered his thesis about the best of all possible worlds to be confirmed by the unification of the laws of physics that we have witnessed in the past decades, and especially by current hopes of finding a theory of everything, that is, a single theory that governs all four of the basic physical forces. Even more pertinent to Leibniz's argument is the current discussion of fine-tuning and the anthropic principle. Here I refer to the work of scientists such as John Barrow and Frank Tipler, who have marshaled 680 pages of calculations showing that the development of life in the universe is dependent upon exquisitely fine balances among the forces and quantities of basic physics. These calculations have led to reflections on the abstract possibility of a vast number of different sets of physical laws. These reflections, in turn, allow us to make better sense of Leibniz's notion of God selecting the best of all possible worlds. Here, God selects from among a number of possible worlds one of the incredibly small number in which the development of life would be possible. Now, metaphysical evil in the tradition refers to the basic fact of finitude and limitation. Metaphysical evil has regularly been seen as either a condition for or an occasion for both natural and moral evil. I believe light can be shed on this ancient idea by focusing on one particular law of nature, the second law of thermodynamics, also known as the law of entropy. Robert Russell argues that entropy is a prefiguring of evil on the physical level. Evil is likened to a disorder, a dysfunction in an organism, an obstruction to growth, or an imperfection in being. Entropy refers to such disorder, measuring the dissipation of a system. We need only to think of the pain and cost of natural disasters to recognize the extent of suffering in this world. All these are rooted in the press of entropy, the relentless disintegration of form, environment, organism. Furthermore, the constant need to replenish the human body, the need for food and other forms of energy, is the cause of much moral evil. While we may dream of a world without this constant loss and degradation of energy, Russell argues that the second law actually plays a necessary catalytic role in the development of higher forms of order, particularly in the development of life. So, we can see that these scientific considerations give theologians additional resources for dealing with evil. Thomas Aquinas claimed that God caused natural evil per accidens, that is, by accident. I prefer to make the point that natural and metaphysical evil are both necessary but unwanted byproducts of conditions that were required to fulfill God's purposes, including particularly the existence of beings who could freely return his love. One obvious condition for such beings is an orderly, law-like universe. And now we can see, in addition, that human life could only exist in a universe that operates according to laws practically indistinguishable from those we observe. If the existence of intelligent life is central to God's purposes in creating the universe, then this universe is indeed one of the best of all possible worlds. Now, I think I've used up a lot of time. Yes? But I've barely scratched the surface of all of the positive dialogues among scientists, theologians, and philosophers. But I hope that this is enough to further whet your appetites for information on the positive relations between science and religion. Thank you.
Well, Dr. Murphy, would you mind answering a few questions?
I would be happy to.
Okay. Thank you very much for your talk. I was trying to understand your argument relating to the second law of thermodynamics and the problem of evil. So, as I understand it, you're saying that the second law exists and allows for some form of evolution, but simultaneously creates evil. Is that a basic summary?
Yes, and I believe it's largely owing to the work of the Russian Ilya Prigogine and his partner Stengers, I can't remember her first name, who showed that in a system that is far from thermodynamic equilibrium, a jolt of energy can actually cause the system to rise to a higher level of organization. And that is what begins to answer the long-standing question of how it could be possible that on the one hand we see a world in which things of greater and greater complexity have arisen over time, yet the law of entropy would predict that the organization and complexity would always be running down.
So just to follow up on that, it seems though that's you were using that as an explanation for evil's existence in the world. And so my question would be was why is God in any way constrained to work with kind of any of the frameworks that we're thinking with? Why can't God just create an entirely new framework and just say, all right, no evil? Why is it necessary to work with the second law?
Well, one question is, why didn't God just create a world the way Jews and Christians imagine the next life to be? That is, the lion and the kid shall lie down together and no more tears shed and so forth. And I think the answer to that question is that the concept of moral goodness or virtue is a concept that requires development over time. And I think there are some very solid arguments to the effect that you couldn't just create good human beings de novo out of their parents' wombs. You have to learn to be courageous. You have to learn to be generous and so forth. And so we need to have begun our existence in a world that has these sorts of moral challenges. And then, of course, the fine-tuning plays a huge role here, and that's why I found it such a fascinating topic. It's because you couldn't just pluck out the second law of thermodynamics without everything else going haywire. I have a former student and colleague who was with me at the Vatican conference where we worked on this problem of evil. And he said, but couldn't God have made just one less mosquito in Minnesota? And when you get to that point, you just have to throw up your hands and say, I don't know why. It's like you can talk about the finger of God, but you can't ask whether his nails are well manicured or not.
We got one right back here first.
Regarding your view on evolution, so what distinguishes mankind from the animals from which we evolved?
I think what we've found, what ethologists and especially primatologists have discovered, is that there's no single feature that humans possess and that can't be found in at least minimal form amongst the animals. And so language use was often cited as what makes us unique. And sophisticated language does indeed make us unique. But nonetheless, bonobos and other great apes can be taught very, very rudimentary language. So there's not an absolute divide there. If you think of rationality in the sense of acting reasonably, well, obviously the animals that we know and love do that pretty much all of the time. You know, your pet dog remembers where the dog bones are and in the closet and so forth, and knows which door to scratch on if he wants one. Then there's a question of morality, and ethologist Frans de Waal, he's Dutch, DEWAAL, he has a book titled Good Natured, and he argues that we see pro-social and proto-moral characteristics in animals, especially in herd animals. So for instance, he talks about a colony of mongoose. I don't know what the plural of mongoose is. Mongeese. And when one of them got sick and could no longer climb up on the box where they put out the food, the others in the group would bring food down to it, and they would lay next to it and keep it warm. And in fact, they were so attached to it that they finally had to remove the cadaver from the cage because the rest of the company wanted to keep him. And just other terribly cute little stories like that. One that I love is a little two-year-old boy somehow or other climbed over the fence in a zoo and fell in the gorilla cage. And of course the humans were terrified. The huge mama gorilla is dashing over to the little boy, and they assume that she's going to tear him to pieces or eat him or something. But what she does is she scoops him up and very tenderly and gently carries him over to the gate to her pen so that the zookeeper can take him out. Just all sorts of neat little things like that.
Yeah, sorry. You almost answered this in the first question, but I thought I would follow up. Where science has, you know, scientific theory, which I would say is something they can follow through to find truth in various different areas of life, what would theologians have as a methodology for discovering truth? And if they, and I guess the follow up to that would be, if they had one, would they be willing to follow it wherever it led? Whatever that meant.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that Christians do have techniques that are already recorded in the New Testament, but have not been followed nearly as frequently or powerfully as they need to, and it's called the theory of discernment. And so if you ask, does religious experience actually give you new knowledge about God? Everybody knows about all of the crazy things that believers have done in the name of God, but that's because an individual's experience or idea or whatever is not tested by the rest of the community. And the qualities by which experience are supposed to be tested is that they have to be at least somehow congruent with the original teachings. Can't be perfect mimics of them or else there'd be no progress. And they have to lead to the fruits of the Spirit in the life of the individual and the community. That is, they need to lead to more faith and hope and charity and so forth. And if that process were employed on a regular basis, and if people went into the process with the real intention of seeking truth and following where it led, then I believe we would have much less of the discord amongst Christians that we see today, and there would be much more of coming to consensus between or among different Christian bodies.
Well, we won't catch your voice any further.
Okay.
So, thank you so much.
Thank you.